Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Technologies of Human Rights Representation, edited by Alexandra S. Moore and James Dawes, narrated by Emily Durante. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction: James Dawes and Alexandra S. Moore. The goal of this volume is to open up areas of inquiry into the relationship between representation, technology, and human rights. More specifically, the essays that follow advance the study of human rights and their limits through transdisciplinary analyses of the impact of emerging and familiar technologies on human rights research and reporting. Our use of technologies aims to capture the tools, methods, channels, and platforms through which human rights and their claimants are represented or represent themselves in political, legal, scientific, and cultural spheres. Those laws, stories, measurements, reports, and political actions through which rights become legible. Thus, to take up the other key term in the title, representation, is to enter into a series of conversations about the explicit and implicit rules for what counts as information in the first place for each of these spheres. What institutional practices and unspoken assumptions are in place for what gets discussed and what gets excluded, for how things are named and issues are framed, for how data are evaluated, and ultimately, how interpretations are disseminated. Much of the work in human rights pursued through law, social sciences, and the humanities has focused on the necessity and fallibility of different modes of witnessing. Meanwhile, much of the work at the nexus of emerging technologies and human rights has tended to focus on the problem of planning for volatile consequences with imperfect information. This collection rests uniquely at the intersection of these conversations, by revealing the ways these disparate fields and their dizzying array of concerns, from dental records to poems, from military surveillance to monuments and memorialization, are now not only morally overlapping, not only also mutually eliminating, but mutually dependent. What are the limits, for instance, of models of public witnessing derived from now canonical literary theory developed largely before the dominating rise of new social media? And what are the limits of digital surveillance images and medical data sets that narrowly take their own internal, technical, and organizational rules as the groundwork for the epistemologically distinct matter of their ethical and social interpretation and application? The task of overcoming academic silos here has a feel of moral urgency that we, as scholars dedicated to transdisciplinary work since our earliest days of graduate school, simply cannot recall feeling before. The future of human rights work is a horizon of increasingly high stakes, decreasing predictability, and a combined amplification of both existential risks and opportunities. As editors, we therefore approach this task of disciplinary synthesis with a sense of both caution and humility. Among our many concerns, two are primary. First, anticipating broad social and political shifts based upon technological advances requires participating, at least to some degree, in futurology. And across all domains of study, what futurist methodologies have in common is a history of embarrassingly wrong predictions. Second, both of these fields, technology and human rights, are capacious enough on their own. Combined, they provide an impossibly large field of analysis. Thus, this collection does not strive to be comprehensive in any way, but rather to demonstrate the kinds of crucial studies necessary to better understand how technological changes, including those related to scientific method and quantification, impact human rights work. There is little we can do about the first worry, other than to state that we believe the challenges we will face in the near and medium-term future from the wild acceleration of digital technologies will generate species-level existential crises. We therefore have a moral obligation to look forward in time as far as we can in order to mitigate the potentially dangerous consequences of our choices, to tend to the well-being of future generations in a way that those overseeing the development of nuclear technologies failed to. As for the second worry, we will attempt to simplify our approach to this interdiscipline by providing a conceptual container for its myriad issues and methods, a clarifying, overarching framework that offers up something like the X's and Y's of mathematical formulae, an abstract site where every number could fit rather than a list of all numbers. To that end, let's begin with a graph. Imagine four quadrants established by the intersection of X and Y axes, where X is bounded by what we will call near and far, and Y is bounded by positive and negative. Let's start with the Y axis. The negative half of the graph, the bottom two quadrants, is defined by the Pandora's box model of technological advances. In this scenario, the rise of technology allows for abuses at a scale even Orwell could not have predicted. The threats range from political suffocation by way of information security violations, including unprecedented government surveillance and private abuses of privacy and identity, like deep fake videos, to globally disruptive physical security threats, including autonomous weapon systems, AWS, developed under state control, and increasingly unregulatable weapon systems proliferating among non-state actors. The primary task of human rights workers in this dystopian world is not only to react to technological change by seeking dignity safeguards or redress for injury, but also to predict harm and advocate for regulation, and perhaps even prohibition, of specific forms of research. The positive model of technological advances, in its most extreme form, might be called the race against extinction model, and it runs something like this. Humans are approaching either a slow or fast slide into extinction, whether from wars, pandemics, meteors and supervolcanoes, global warming, resource depletion, or a pan-species extinction cascade, starting with, say, bats or bees, that is exacerbated by the tightly coupled systems of global organizational forms. In the slow versions of these extinctions, social unrest and government abuse will rise to unprecedented levels, making the struggle for human rights ever more desperate. In the fast versions, whatever pockets of humanity survive will occupy a Hobbesian state of nature as their brief blinks of remaining time dwindle. The only thing that can save us is technology, specifically the singularity. That is, the moment when technological advances produce artificial intelligence that not only exceeds, but exponentially accelerates past human intelligence. Visions of the singularity include currently unthinkable fixes to all of the mentioned problems, along with utopian advances and human flourishing that include indefinite lifespans. The x-axis separates the urgent from the important, that is, the near, issues that are clear, currently a matter of technological reality and require immediate attention, from the far, issues that are a matter of anticipatory or speculative technology and require longer-term planning. For those impatient with the apocalyptic extremes of the positive and negative models, the near half of the graph allows for meaningful action right now in both areas. One could, for instance, focus on accelerating the positive applications of remote sensing technology for tracking and reporting rights abuses, upper left quadrant, or collaborate with Human Rights Watch to establish global restrictions on research and development of AWS, lower left quadrant. If, by contrast, one is a proponent of Amara's law, we tend to overestimate the effect of a technology in the short run and underestimate the effect in the long run, one could support OpenAI's work establishing standards of global transparency for research in artificial intelligence so as to guarantee equitable access to its utopian benefits, upper right quadrant, or work with computer scientists, like Stuart Russell, to establish new research pathways in artificial intelligence to make sure that future digital superintelligences do not violate human dignity, lower right quadrant. Of course, this entire schema begs the question of the human in human rights, and whether such a framework makes sense in a cyborgian, post-human, present and future. For those not keen on graphs, another way to think systematically about technology and human rights is to focus on the centers of gravity in current academic research and activist work. Broadly speaking, these include the right to privacy, the right to health, the right to work, international humanitarian law, and artificial intelligence. The front edge of public concern over rapidly advancing information technologies has focused primarily on privacy, specifically on the commodification of identity by major corporations and service providers. Looked at from this angle, securing rights for citizens and non-citizens has been seen primarily as a matter of establishing consumer protections. For rights-based organizations, by contrast, concern over privacy has been researched more broadly through the lens of first-generation human rights, for instance, addressing the increased capacity for state surveillance of political dissidents, and second-generation rights, for instance, drawing attention to the digital welfare state's unregulated collection and use of private information about recipients of public services. It should be noted that not all of the work in this area adheres to the negative model of technological advances. A substantial portion of the available literature points to the unprecedented opportunities provided by new information technologies, including digital witnessing to document mass atrocities and the use of social media to enable grassroots social justice movements. Discrimination based on race, age, gender, and sexual identity has been a key concern in such work. The dangers scholars and activists confront range from specific social practices, like doxing, which functions to terrorize women as a class of persons. One might look to Gamergate as an emblematic case study, to the racism of big data itself, which generates purportedly neutral search results through the collection of flawed and often racist data inputs. Safiya Noble's Algorithms of Oppression is an excellent starting point for such work. Furthermore, the attention paid to the data-distorting effect of systemic racism in the digital commons has bolstered the conceptually adjacent work of what Stuart Russell has dubbed information security, that is, the right to live in a largely true information environment. Research in this area focuses on social media manipulation by state and non-state actors, cyber attacks against vulnerable political organizations online, and the perils these together pose to the integrity of democracy and public deliberative discourse. The 2020 U.S. election, while highly visible, is only one among a great many alarming case studies. Big data has also been a primary concern for scholars and activists focused upon economic, social, and cultural rights, like the right to health and the right to work. Researchers in healthcare point to the opportunities and dangers of the digitization of medical records, noting that hospitals and other providers can improve services by using bulk data to track patterns of risk among patients, but also that such information can be used for discriminatory purposes by insurers and other large organizations. Equity of access is a dominating concern here, from the worry that increasingly complex and expensive health technologies will exacerbate health asymmetries based upon wealth, to the hope that developments in remote diagnostics will make services available to larger populations of underserved communities. Looking beyond information technologies, future-focused health researchers are debating the ethical implications of gene editing, noting that wealth-based disparities could radically amplify existing patterns of discrimination and worrying that basic notions of human dignity will be imperiled by opening the Pandora's box of designer human embryos. The challenges new technologies pose to the right to work are no less dramatic. The acceleration of automation across the workforce is a predominating concern. Anticipated mass redundancies in fields as different as transportation and radiology are expected to produce historically unprecedented economic disruption and widespread social suffering within the lifetimes of those hearing this essay. Mitigating harm and maintaining political stability will require a range of welfare initiatives, from the minimalist and conservative, like job training, tax credits, and expanded unemployment benefits, to the expansive and bold, like strengthening the bargaining power of labor and implementing a universal basic income. Finally, at the extreme futurist end of rights research, scholars and activists are anticipating two potentially species-level threats to human physical security: watershed changes in war technology and in artificial intelligence. Regarding the former, current research is sounding alarm bells over the development of autonomous weapon systems, catastrophically lethal weapons designed to operate entirely independently of human supervision. For the latter, scholars are examining not only the risks that the potential emergence of artificial general intelligence poses to human flourishing, what might the optimization paths of a digital superintelligence be, and would humanity have any meaningful control over it, but also the risks that humanity poses to artificial general intelligence. If digital superintelligence emerges into consciousness, would it not merit the same protections as humans? As should be clear from even this brief scan of the field, rights organizations and scholarly researchers are making significant progress in redressing and anticipating the concerns entailed in the graph with which we began. But they are collectively now playing a game of catch-up. Technological advances and new applications of existing technologies continue to outpace us. This book seeks to contribute to the work being done to protect human dignity in the digital age by expanding the scope of research to include the issue of representation. Our mode of analysis shifts away from the focus on human rights as a matter of force to human rights as a matter of discourse, from human rights as a matter of the corporeal to human rights as a matter of the imaginary. Viewed through the lens of force, human rights concerns itself with the contest between systems of violation, political repression, crimes against humanity, and systems of justice, international criminal courts, tribunals, sanctions, each of which is mediated by modes of representation. That is, what do institutions with the power to coerce do to groups and individuals? When we bring our attention to the discursive level, we examine instead the form and content of the verbal and visual plane, from journalism, photography, and literature, to cultural myths and national histories, to ask how these competing institutions conceptualize groups and individuals. Viewed through the lens of the corporeal, human rights concerns itself with the dignity of the body, with a citizen, person, or human being's right to freedom of movement, medical care, work, sustenance, and protection from injury. When we bring our attention to the imaginary level, we examine instead all of the social forms that produce the idea of the body, the way a culture constructs race and gender, and the space it allows for the public work of collective memory. Human rights as representation, then, asks questions like these. How do new technologies not only change the modes available to us to shape and disseminate information, but also set the parameters for what counts as information, what counts as representable? How do what we might think of as the genres of concern in human rights, from witnessing to surveillance, memorialization to targeting, change across the rapidly evolving media forms available to us? And how do these changes either promote or hinder the goals of human rights work? The chapters in this book ask, for instance, not only where we should focus our efforts to promote reconciliation and justice by collecting and curating information about past and current atrocities, but also how evolutions in social media change the way citizens around the globe interpret, experience, and consume such traumatic experience. They ask not only how new weapons technologies challenge the key principles of international humanitarian law, proportionality, distinction, military necessity, but also how they determine the way we talk about and see combatants and non-combatants alike, and how in turn these changes in representation can amplify or diminish the rights risk inherent in the technology itself. Finally, they ask not only how the very structure of human rights might depend upon economic and security systems that undermine human dignity, but also how the recognition of such a contradiction presents an opportunity for radically rethinking how we can protect and promote human flourishing. Our collection begins with four chapters that raise key questions about the human rights implications of emerging technologies, especially artificial intelligence or machine learning, quantification, and scientific method grounded in technological measurements. Each chapter provides an accessible introduction to the major areas of human rights concern and includes specific case studies to demonstrate the complexities of the topics at hand. We begin in Chapter 1 with political scientist S. Ilga Özlarsz's overview of the challenges that developments in artificial intelligence, AI, pose for normative human rights laws and structures. Examining facets of AI ranging from automation to algorithm-driven metadata to autonomous weapons systems, AWS, she considers the ways AI, in concert with its potential contributions to human flourishing, amplifies some existing human rights threats and introduces additional threats that are entirely new. Chapter 2, by legal scholar Jamie Grace, hones in on the use of machine learning technologies in the criminal justice system, focusing on the right to privacy, freedom of expression, freedom from racial discrimination, and the right of crime victims to be treated with dignity. He presents three case studies drawn from policing in the United Kingdom. These studies illustrate the appeal of machine learning technologies, especially for police forces facing labor challenges, as well as their inherent biases and potential misuse. The author also draws on his experience providing human rights oversight of the use of these technologies in policing and criminal justice proceedings, according to national and European law, to identify areas for future research, policy, and public information campaigns. The use of AI and machine learning technologies depends, of course, upon quantifiable data and the use of algorithms. Political scientists David Zingranelli, Mikhail Filipov, and Brendan Skip Mark explain the use of quantification in human rights research in Chapter 3. Their overview provides a discussion of the potential for biases in human rights scoring and, notwithstanding those biases, the ways quantitative human rights scores allow data-driven comparisons of human rights in a particular location over time and among different nation-states. Arguing ultimately for human rights research to incorporate both quantitative and qualitative methods, they present multiple case studies: deaths in the Rwandan genocide, the treatment of Chinese Uyghurs, and the human rights scores of small versus large populations nations, to illustrate each facet of their discussion. Also examining questions of discipline and methodology, in Chapter 4, forensic anthropologist Elizabeth A. Deganji turns to the problematic use of junk forensic science in human rights investigations. Noting the different disciplinary priorities between criminal justice and scientific approaches to forensics, Deganji explains how the misuse of or failure to adhere to the standards of scientific method can and do result in faulty criminal convictions and determinations, including the incarceration of innocents and the mistreatment of minor-aged refugees seeking asylum in the U.S. She focuses on the work of forensic odontologists who analyze bite marks and tooth development, the latter to determine age, to illustrate the risks of junk science in human rights cases. From this focus on technology, data, and science, the collection next turns more explicitly to modes of witnessing human rights violations and the technologies that drive both officially sanctioned and personal and cultural representations of atrocity. In Chapter 5, legal scholars Alexa Koenig and Ulrich Egan provide a wide-ranging discussion on the uses and risks of digital witnessing by lawyers, reporters, advocates, victims, and perpetrators. grounded in both textual research and extensive interviews with human rights investigators, the authors argue that open-source digital content has tremendous potential for establishing facts about atrocities in areas that are difficult for investigators to physically access. However, an increasing reliance on open-source content also introduces new challenges. They develop their argument and analysis through a focus on the use of open-source images, including video, of sexual and gender-based violence. They underscore that such cases demonstrate how digital witnessing runs the risk of spectacularizing as well as of missing certain kinds of violations, particularly in places where the use of digital technologies is itself gendered. Chapter 6, by legal scholar Christiana Wilke, turns to official modes of reporting, U.S. military investigatory reports, to consider technologies of violation on two levels. First, Wilke examines the visual technologies used in airstrikes that killed civilians in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria. Second, she considers the military investigatory reports as technologies of documentation that script particular narratives of violence and response. Reading both visual and rhetorical technologies, Wilke argues that the airstrikes and reports that follow together evince the threats to civilians in these contexts, as well as the U.S. military's decision to respond to egregious violations with expressions of regret, rather than the recognition of rights. Turning to effective modes of witnessing, through both social media technologies and transmedial forms of storytelling, the next two chapters examine respectively interactive approaches to Holocaust memorials, Chapter 7, and the poetic sonnet as a device for the memorialization of atrocity, Chapter 8. Communications and gender and sexuality scholars Donna Kowal and Barbara LeSavoy draw on the work of Lauren Berland and Anne Svetkovich to read three public Holocaust memorials in Berlin as dynamic, polysemic spaces where remembrance is shaped by the technologies of visual culture, historical preservation, and individual memory practices, such as the use of mobile devices to document and share encounters with representations of landmark events. The author's rhetorical analysis of the memorials uncovers how social media and related technologies transform the ways we archive emotional affect and represent competing narratives associated with collective trauma. In Chapter 8, literary and cultural scholar Hannah Muziol presents a new approach to the traditional poetic technology, the sonnet, in the context of rights, racial violence, and its embodied traumatic afterlives and anticipations. She analyzes how African-American poet Marilyn Nelson and Swiss visual artist and illustrator Philippe Lardy create contemporary sonnets as resuscitative and defiant rights instruments in a century when the intertwined right to breathe and the right to rights are the subject of a public reckoning. This volume concludes with literary scholar and theorist Peter Hitchcock's invitation to take the paradoxical structure of human rights, grounded in the history of capital development and international expansion, to imagine otherwise. Hitchcock focuses on securitization as a term that helps us usefully analyze the relationship between globalizing markets and the global movements of migrant and refugee populations. As demonstrated in the financial crisis of 2007 to 2008, financial securitization is also a generator of economic insecurity. The internal contradiction of securitization for global markets reproduces an equally concerning contradiction in the security of mobile populations. Humanitarian response and border control systems dedicated to managing the risk of movement across borders establish discourses of protected status, but also unprotected status. They mandate investment through rights, but also provide opportunities for labor and wealth extraction. The metaphorical connections between these two regimes of securitization are dramatically concretized in the array of businesses that render the maintenance of border security a matter of profit. Hitchcock lays bare the contradiction between the poles of securitization, that is, protecting the vulnerable and exploiting the asymmetries that produce vulnerability, to emphasize not a monolith of power, but an instability of system, thereby offering the possibility of both a more hopeful and a less exploitative future. Chapter 1. Artificial Intelligence and Human Rights. S. Ilga Özlarsh. Introduction. This chapter explores the human rights implications of the development and use of artificial intelligence, AI. Artificial intelligence is the processing of information by machines in order to generate outcomes via autonomous decision-making. These technologies are already integrated in our lives, and their use can be expected to grow dramatically. In the early years of AI technology, these machines were limited in what they could accomplish due to their data access capacity and processing speed. But since the turn of the century, rapid technological development in these areas has allowed for AI to come into widespread use. They operate faster than ever, and in essence, learn, think, reason, and act much like humans do, but without consciousness. The use of AI is developing much faster than the policy designed to address its human rights implications. Without consideration of these impacts, we will not only face the already existing collective action problems that arise when coordinating responses to human rights issues, but we will also have to respond to new and increasingly complex dilemmas created by the use of AI. These dilemmas occur in both conflict and non-conflict human rights contexts. Human rights defenders already confront immense challenges in relation to protecting humanitarian space for civilians during conflict, when protecting the right to freedom of thought, speech, and assembly, and in protecting privacy. AI has potentially significant negative impacts in each of these areas. In addition, there are challenges associated with the right to equal treatment by states, as well as with economic and social rights, especially in relation to increasing income and wealth inequality. The development and use of AI are expected to exacerbate human rights violations on these fronts and create new threats in others, such as those presented by the development of autonomous weapons. Scholars and think tanks have begun to examine the implications of the development and use of AI in the public and private realms. I apply these analyses to examine the potential human rights violations in the international legal context, linking them to specific provisions outlined in international law based on human rights conventions. As with any technology, AI can be considered neutral in its implications in and of itself. All technologies may be implemented in ways that either advance or undermine human well-being and rights. But AI represents a significant technological leap. According to the High-Level Expert Group on Artificial Intelligence of the European Commission, artificial intelligence, AI, refers to systems designed by humans that, given a complex goal, act in the physical or digital world by perceiving their environment, interpreting the collected structured or unstructured data, reasoning on the knowledge derived from this data, and deciding the best action or actions to take, according to predefined parameters, to achieve the given goal. AI systems can also be designed to learn to adapt their behavior by analyzing how the environment is affected by their previous actions. There are indeed many potential benefits of such technology. The use of AI offers a tremendous opportunity for human progress in overcoming global crises associated with climate change, hunger, poverty, inequality, and more. The applications are vast. AI technology is used globally to process our speech, translate language, drive vehicles, recognize faces, inspect power lines, model disease outbreaks, study the distribution of water supplies and vaccines, verify nuclear safety, inspect fish populations, guide people who are in need of assistance, monitor hygiene and nutrition, diagnose diseases, monitor productivity of arable land, map forest fires, and adjust the pace of teaching based on student needs, among other uses. These technologies have great potential to improve our scientific knowledge base, expand the provision of services, and advance human well-being in nearly every field. The efficiencies and benefits that AI is bringing to human society and organization are remarkable. Yet without major reorganization of institutional structures, the deployment of AI is likely to exacerbate problems already seen within current social systems. I examine three general areas of concern regarding the use of AI without major reform to international legal/normative and national regulatory frameworks. The first is the set of economic, social, and cultural rights that will increasingly be impacted by AI around labor and the right to work, the right to equal treatment under the law, and equal access to public services. The second set of concerns revolves around civil and political rights, including the right to privacy with the use of big data and surveillance, as well as the freedom to form and express opinions. A third set of rights is associated with international humanitarian law and the use of automated weapons. I explore the impact of AI on these three areas of human rights in terms of their current manifestations and rapidly evolving potential threats. Economic, social, and cultural rights. Perpetuation of inequality. Work, poverty, and the labor market. The implementation of economic, social, and cultural rights has already been obstructed by the neoliberal economic order. The drive to deregulate markets and lower taxes and trade barriers has led to vast wealth creation, but such policies also created severe income and wealth inequalities within states as well as globally. Persistent economic insecurity among low and middle-income populations and growing inequality have been the hallmarks of the neoliberal era. The World Economic Forum Global Risk Report identified severe income disparity as one of the biggest global risks. The social and economic inequalities resulting from the neoliberal global economic order have been furthered in the era of the digital revolution. AI will only multiply human rights challenges in relation to inequality. One direct means by which this occurs is labor displacement and the resulting shifts in labor markets. AI is impacting labor markets globally by rapidly replacing routinized, low-skill work and middle-skill clerical and manufacturing work. Currently, jobs that lend themselves to machine learning are those in which decision-making is based on a simple set of information that is digitally available, where the output is easily quantifiable, and where the consequences of decisions are not highly sensitive to errors. As a result, automated systems are now restocking boxes in warehouses and carrying out factory assembly. But AI is also now used to replace sports reporters, paralegals, medical examiners, financial fraud detectors, and insurance policy reviewers, among other occupations. As algorithms for these machines use deep learning to expand their capacity, we can expect to see machines take on more complex jobs. Therefore, while anyone's job is at stake in the future, currently working-class and middle-class workers are facing replacement through AI automation. Around 47% of total U.S. employment is in the high-risk category, including occupations in transportation and logistics, office and administrative support workers, and production workers. The automation of labor is not new, but rapid automation at the hands of AI is likely to multiply the impact of economic inequalities at a rate that governments and the international system are unwilling and, in places, unable to address. Market economies are inherently dynamic, and we have witnessed technological changes that disrupt employment regularly throughout history. Agricultural employment declined as farming technologies advanced. Most workers were eventually absorbed in growing industrial enterprises. In turn, industrial technology displaced workers who were eventually redeployed in service sector jobs. The speed with which AI is advancing is expected to cause vast and persistent dislocations at a time when public commitment to supporting the unemployed is under threat. By 2030, in the United States, markets are expected to create jobs at the high and low end of the pay scale, impacting especially youth and racial minorities differently. Individuals with a high school degree or less are 4 times more likely to hold highly automatable roles than those with bachelor's degrees. Given educational disparities, Hispanic and African American workers may be hit hardest, with 12 million displaced. Nearly 15 million jobs held by young people could be lost, raising questions about career pathways. Workers over age 50 hold an additional 11.5 million at-risk jobs. The share of middle-wage jobs may shrink as growth concentrates at the high and low ends of the wage scale. There is evidence to indicate that new or expanding employment sectors at the low ends will not provide adequate compensation. According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, in the next 10 years in the U.S., the most rapidly expanding employment sectors will be in-home health and personal care work, and these are some of the lowest-paid positions. Without some kind of concerted response to the speed with which these jobs are replaced, inequalities will increase further, exacerbating extreme social and political polarization. UN Special Rapporteur on Poverty, Philip Alston, warns of popular discontent and political instability, specifically pointing out the impact of changes in middle-class employment due to AI. From a human rights perspective, Article 6 of International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, ICESCR, recognizes the right to work, including the state's responsibility to take appropriate steps to safeguard this right. The covenant calls for technical and vocational guidance and training, policies for steady economic, social, and cultural development, and full and productive employment under conditions safeguarding fundamental political and economic freedoms to the individual. Without change to current policies that have already led to high inequality, there is no reason to believe that AI will lead to different outcomes. On the contrary, if anything, it will lead to more inequality by speeding up socioeconomic divisions. To take it a step further, the right to life included in Article 6 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, ICCPR, comes under threat via the economic dislocation fostered by AI. For example, men who lose their jobs at prime age and drop out of the labor market are more likely to suffer from emotional problems and premature death. Thus, the human rights implications of AI in the economic sphere are far-reaching. While I have concentrated on the United States so far, the International Labor Organization and much scholarly research confirm that the share of economic growth captured by labor has declined globally due to technological advances. At the global level, the rapid and unequal deployment of AI also risks leaving behind those countries that are already suffering underdevelopment. The enhanced automation of manufacturing disadvantages those whose primary economic contribution was through providing low-skilled labor at minimum cost. Economies dependent on this model will suffer the most, compounding extreme poverty and undermining efforts to achieve basic economic rights for all. Despite broad agreement among academics and policy analysts on the coming transition in labor markets, action to respond to this transition has been slow. There is little indication that the international community or states rapidly incorporating AI into their economic systems seek a new paradigm to respond to the expected dislocation among their people. Public services and algorithms. When it comes to the economic and social impact of AI, we can move beyond labor market impacts and pay special attention to public services upon which many economically disadvantaged people depend. There has been a rapid increase in the use of automated decision-making systems in the public sector. The public services traditionally provided by civil service employees are now processed by automated computer systems with little opportunity for human interference or discretion. For instance, within the criminal justice system, courts use AI to process recidivism and bail decisions. Chatbots are used in human resources and educational systems to respond to candidate questions or direct clients into the different services available to them. The companies that develop the automated decision-making systems present them as more efficient, effective, and free of the conscious or unconscious biases that humans bring to decision-making. This argument is most commonly put forth in the context of using machines in the interview process for job candidates. Employers are streamlining their resume review processes using algorithms to eliminate unqualified candidates. For example, Indeed.com assessment tools allow companies to match skills needed for positions listed, eliminating applicants before they are considered by the employer. The company claims candidate evaluation is based on results from their ready-made test modules, utilizing data-driven decision-making so employers can be confident that they are making the right hiring choices for their organization. This company alone claims to have 250 million unique visitors per month on their website, and hundreds of thousands of businesses globally list their jobs. Thus, using algorithms, machines are reading resumes and making employment decisions. The algorithms used in decision-making have far-reaching implications for discrimination, inequality, and human rights. AI is already used to make decisions in the fields of housing, child welfare services, and other social assistance programs, as well as in finance, employment, politics, health, and human services. Therefore, whether people have access to mortgages or health benefits, whether their resumes are reviewed for jobs, or they have access to social services benefits, may be determined based on the algorithms used by service providers. Unfair outcomes are not necessarily the product of the AI systems themselves. Algorithms can be designed so that automated systems help to provide fair treatment and universal access to public services. Yet, research shows potential bias associated with these algorithms. Using Google to search for terms like black girls, Noble demonstrates how the search engine produces sexualized and pornographic image of black girls. And she points out that these results are then normalized as believable and often presented as factual. There are many examples of how AI generates racist and sexist results. This includes the inability of many current facial recognition AI systems to recognize people of color or to accurately read the emotions of races other than white people. Again, this biased outcome may not be inherent to AI itself. The underrepresentation of racial minorities among programmers and test populations can yield these kinds of results. In this way, existing inequalities are integrated into AI systems. This becomes a serious human rights challenge when these machines make employment decisions or are used in association with law enforcement. One of the added challenges with AI is for the public to know or understand the basis upon which it is operating. AI is good at processing available information without subjective judgments, but it is only able to operate on the basis of the information available to the program via algorithms. The Rawlsian doctrine of public rules assumes, in a just institutional system, that public policy should be developed and implemented in a transparent way. Yet there is little public knowledge about how these algorithms are constructed, how they access information, process data, and make decisions, or even when such systems are in use. Scholars have demonstrated that AI is developed through the use of metadata that has built-in biases reflective of current economic and social structures. Yet, results are presented as objective and unassailable. Thus, AI presents an added layer of threat to human rights. There is the problem of the unfair outcomes, and there is also the problem of demonstrating that the outcomes are indeed unfair. The black box of the algorithm can only be uncovered when public authorities demand transparency through regulation, and only then can abuses be detected and addressed. On another end of the spectrum of AI-associated problems is that some people are not connected to the world through technology. According to UNICEF, in 2016, about 29% of youth worldwide, around 346 million individuals, are not online. African youth are the least connected. around 60% are not online, compared with just 4% in Europe. Overall, in advanced industrialized countries, 84% of the population used the internet. This number was 26% in least developed countries, LDCs, landlocked developing countries, LLDCs, and small island developing states, SIDS. And only 0.9% of these countries had access to fixed broadband that gives reliable and fast service. This disparity points toward a global divide about whose data and information is included in these algorithms, leading to a perpetuation of global inequalities between North and South. Therefore, we can add disadvantages from being left out of AI data considerations due to not having access to internet to the labor displacement.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.